we mourn for our fellow human beings, for George Floyd, and those that cannot breathe.
We gathered to mourn on a Thursday. Bearing candles, we gathered, as if we knew him. Wearing masks to mitigate the spread of the pandemic, we remembered, as if we could possibly understand. In silence, we mourned, as if it were our story. On May 25th, 2020, George Floyd, a 46-year-old resident of Minneapolis, Minnesota, was murdered by the police. His killer had sworn to serve and protect the people of Minneapolis. George Floyd begged for his life as the killer kneeled on his neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. As he died, three other officers looked on, but did not intervene. It's a familiar story, too familiar. George Floyd was not the first to utter the chilling plea of "I can't breathe." He was not the first black life brutally stolen by a blue shirt and a badge. Nor, though little time has passed, was he the last. On Thursday, June 4th, several hundred residents of Canby, Oregon gathered to hold a silent vigil for George Floyd and all victims of police violence and systemic racism.
A vigil is intended to be a time to collectively reflect, to mourn, and to honor. Use this time to silently reflect within yourself. It is the first steps to change.
It is tempting to describe my thoughts and my observations of the gathered crowd, but this is not my story. Nor is it the story of a predominantly white group of people in a small, predominantly white city, in a state founded in the racist ideals of a white utopia, in a country with centuries of racism baked into its systems and culture, in a world plagued with a widespread contagion of colonial white supremacy.
My voice is not the one you should be listening to.
This is the story of George Floyd, a man who was murdered over the simple allegation of passing a counterfeit $20 bill. His life was worth more than $20. No life is worth so little. No murder is justified by such a paltry sum. No amount of capital can ever come close to the value of a human being's life. This is the story of Breonna Taylor, a 26-year-old EMT in Louisville, Kentucky. When plainclothes police officers broke through her front door and invaded her apartment unannounced after midnight on March 13th, her boyfriend, a licensed gun owner, opened fire on what he believed were home invaders. The police fired back. At least 8 bullets entered the body of Breonna Taylor, and she was gone. Killed. Murdered. All in the pursuit of suspected drug dealers who were already in custody, based on a false report that one of the suspects had been receiving packages at Taylor's address. This is the story of Manuel Ellis, a 33-year-old church musician. On March 3rd, he was knocked to the ground and beaten by police in Tacoma, Washington. A witness pleaded with the officers to stop hitting him. In the end, like George Floyd and others before and after him, Manuel Ellis spoke the words, "I can't breathe," as his life was taken. The medical examiner ruled Ellis's death a homicide. This is the story of Deion Johnson, a 28-year-old man in Phoenix, Arizona, who was murdered by police on the very same day that George Floyd's life was stolen. Found sleeping in his car on a piece of land between an on-ramp and the freeway, Johnson was killed when the officer arresting him for driving under the influence shot him in the stomach. The officer's justifications cannot be proven, as there is no footage of or witness to the killing. No body cam, no dash cam, only a traffic cam whose recording did not begin until after Johnson had already been shot. These examples are just a small sampling of black lives killed by police. There have been many more just in this year alone. This is their story, and it is the story of so many more. This is the story of the uncountable number of black lives ruined or murdered by white supremacy wearing the costumes of law and order. This is the story of the black lives that have continued to be stolen by systems of authority even as I'm writing these words. This is the story of the black man at the vigil in Canby who thanked some of us as we were departing. He shouldn't have had to thank us. Caring about his life should be the default. Caring about each other should be the default. For while this is their story, and it is important to focus on that and remember that we do not all experience all plights equally or in the same ways, we are not separate from their stories. We are part of these stories. When a fellow human being dies, how we react to that is part of the story. When systems that benefit some disproportionately punish others, that is part of the story. When we make excuses, that is part of the story. When we refuse to acknowledge pervasive problems, that is part of the story. When we think it doesn't affect us and so detach ourselves, that is part of the story. When we keep quiet because we don't think it's our place to speak up for others, or we're afraid of doing it wrong, that is part of the story. When we refuse to challenge those in our lives who ignore, perpetuate, or commit violence in our society, that is part of the story. To paraphrase John Donne, no person, nor their story, is an island entire of itself. Each is a piece of the continent, a part of the great big story in which all of our stories play a part. When even one life is lost, especially to preventable means, we are all the less for it. We all lose part of what could have been a greater whole. And so it is important that we learn to care about others and their stories as much as we care about our own. Each man's death diminishes me, wrote Donne, for I am involved in mankind. Therefore, send not to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for George Floyd. It tolls for Breonna Taylor. It tolls for Manuel Ellis. It tolls for Deion Johnson. It tolls for the uncountable other Black lives stolen. And, yes, it tolls for thee.